You may have heard in the past, or even from your parents, you are what you eat. And maybe you didn't pay attention to what they meant by that, or you didn't get the full understanding of what that meant. You are what you eat. What does that mean? Or what does that matter, really, right? Today, we're going to dive in a little bit and tell you more about why it is important for you to pay attention to what you eat and how that affects not just your gut, but the way your body functions in general. Thank you for joining us. I am Kameisha with Intentional Nurse Life Balance, and with me today is Dr. Tanya Lambert. Dr. Lambert, thank you so much for joining me.
Well, hello everyone. It's nice to be here with all of you. So yes, gut health is definitely important. And as Nurse Kameisha said,
that's something that personally affects me. So it's something that I am passionate about educating myself on and sharing the information that I learn with others, so they too can be more educated on why the gut is important.
It's very important that we know how our gut functions, because our gut is made up of not just the cells of our own body, but also trillions of bacterial cells, which play an important role in your immune system and regulating your sleep cycles, and also to even digesting your food.
Absolutely. And trust me, a gut that is not properly digesting your food is not a gut that you want to have, and not one that you want to play around with. Believe me. So we're going to talk a little bit about diet and lifestyle and what that has to do with gut and gut health.
As I was saying previously, gut is made up of just about 100 trillion bacterial cells. Interesting enough, in comparison to your very own bodies, our bodies have about, say, 10 to 30 trillion cells. So if you think about it, we're mostly composed of bacteria that help us. So your gut bacteria actually does a lot of important functions. As Nurse Kameisha just said, you know, your gut bacteria play a huge role in digesting your food. And, you know, many people may not be aware that the types of bacteria in your gut play an important role in breaking down, like, the fibers in the plant foods that we eat, like the fruits and the vegetables. Gut bacteria in particular, one called bifidobacterium, it actually breaks down the fibers in the green leafy vegetables that, you know, that's all rave right now for boosting immunity. And when they break down those fibers in, like, kale and your cabbage, it actually ferments to form fatty acids such as the short chain fatty acid called butyrate. And ultimately, those fatty acids are useful in rebuilding and maintaining, like, essentially the structure or the integrity of the gut. If you don't have, you know, the proper functioning of your gut, it can actually predispose you to leaky gut syndrome, something that's not well spoken about, but very important, because when your gut is leaky, you can have the entrance of toxins into your bloodstream, and like lipopolysaccharide from bacteria, which can actually increase your risk for chronic disease. So it's really important that we take care of our guts, eat the right foods to have the right balance of gut bacteria.
Absolutely. And along the same point of that is not having this proper bacteria in your gut to carry out those necessary function of digesting your food can create a whole cascade of other problems that you wouldn't even have thought to imagine that they were affiliated with your gut bacteria being out of balance. Things like having insomnia, acid reflux, GERD, inflammation in your abdomen, not being able to sleep. It's just an array of things that happens when your gut's bacteria is out of balance.
Indeed. And there are two main gut bacteria that, you know, we want to talk about, one of which is bifidobacterium. So your gut bacteria, especially the bifidobacterium, plays a huge role in helping you to maintain a healthy immune system. So there was actually a study that was recently written by a physician named Dr. Christine Bishara, and in her study, it was a review article, but also too was related to some of the patients that were seen in the ICU unit that actually have COVID-19. And what they found was that they actually had higher levels of inflammatory markers, one of which is called interleukin-6. But ultimately, these patients who tended to be obese had lower levels of bifidobacterium. And when you have low levels of bifidobacterium, you actually end up with an imbalance of pro-inflammatory markers versus anti-inflammatory markers. And so patients with severe COVID-19 disease tend to have lower levels of bifidobacterium, and as a result, higher levels of, you know, pro-inflammatory proteins, which increases their risk for severe complications. For example, the cytokine storm. What's interesting to note is that children, on the other hand, have a higher amount of bifidobacterium compared to adults, about 60 to 80%, partly because of their diet. So while children who are breastfed tend to get better, healthier bacteria. And also too, if they're eating lots of fruits and vegetables, they tend to have higher levels of bifidobacterium. But if you're not feeding your gut with proper foods, like fresh fruits, vegetables, whole grains, and you're eating lots of refined foods, white sugar, white flour, greasy fried foods, that ends up increasing the amount of decreasing, actually killing off your good gut bacteria, like the bifidobacterium, resulting in an increase in bad gut bacteria, one of which is enterobacteria, and there's another one called clostridium. So, you know, having the right balance of gut bacteria is so important in helping you to maintain, to reduce pro-inflammatory proteins and increase your anti-inflammatory proteins, and as a result, reduce your risk for obesity, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and also chronic disease.
And it's quite interesting that you mentioned earlier that by eating certain foods, it can actually kill off your good bacteria.
Yes.
You may think, okay, I'm just going to now start eating more of healthier foods and that will take care of it. And that's not usually always the case. When your good bacteria dies, sometimes it takes the act of God to bring the gut's bacteria back up to where it needs to be so that the body can efficiently function like it should. So sometimes what goes along with that is taking a high quality probiotic. And as with everything in this world, not all things are created equal. So you can't just run to the Whole Foods store and say, oh, I'm going to buy this probiotic to replace my probiotic because it has, you know, 10,000 CFUs or whatever it is. There are certain specific things that you have to look for in probiotic to determine whether or not it is good for you.
In addition to diet, probiotics, they're also an important supplement that can be included in your diet. So with probiotics, the thing about it is no two individuals, say gut bacteria profiles, are alike. In fact, you know, there might actually be the 10% similarity between, say, my gut and your gut. So, you know, one probiotic choice may not work for everyone. So it's really important that you choose one that works best. When choosing a probiotic, you know, you want to make sure it has, you know, bifidobacterium or lactobacillus, because those two are the healthy bacteria that you want in your gut. You want to make sure that you look at the colony forming units. So you want it to be over 2 billion colony forming units. You don't want it to be too low because essentially it sometimes as the capsule passes through your digestive system, some of the bacteria may be lost. So you want to have a large enough CFU. You also want to look at the expiration date because sometimes we just pick up the probiotics and we didn't check the expiration date. You want to make sure they're alive. And also look at how you are, the instructions as to how they should be maintained. So if they should have been in a refrigerator, but you bought it sitting on a shelf, it might not be alive when you are ingesting it.
Right.
So it's really important to read that because the store clerks may not know how to properly keep the probiotics, and then you're wasting money on expensive probiotics and you're not getting the benefit from it. So it's important to like do your research too, and also to how the probiotic was prepared, and make sure that you have, if you're going to get a capsule, that it is enteric coated, so that it actually maintains, it stays intact until it gets into the lower part of your GI tract, or your colon especially. That's really important. Now, typically, you know, for individuals who can't tolerate capsules, there are certain yogurt brands that can be used. Like Coco Yo is one, and one is Coconut. Oh, that's another one. They're a little on the pricey side, but they're actually very good. And also to making sure that if you get a probiotic yogurt, there's no added sugar. That's something that people forget about. Added sugar is actually not good for your gut.
No. And something else that goes along with that too is prebiotics. And that's something that's commonly not spoken about unless you're having digestive issues and doing your own research to where you come to the realization that when you feed your body good bacteria, it also needs, those good bacteria need to eat in order to stay alive. So they now need probiotic, which is their food, and that is going to sustain them so that they can carry out the necessary functions in your body.
So that's the term prebiotic is one that's not typically mentioned. Unfortunately, most people hear the word probiotic, which we just mentioned is the bacteria, the living substances, essentially, that you see that are in our guts that protect us and maintain our gut integrity. Prebiotics, as Nurse Kameisha just said, it feeds the bacteria in your gut. So your prebiotics include like your green leafy vegetables, you know, and fruits and whole grains. Some things that people may want to consider are your fermented foods like kimchi or even sauerkraut, you know, tempeh. You know, those are foods that are definitely good to keep to consume, because they actually include, they have the probiotics for one, but they also have the prebiotics to the fiber that they like to eat. So it's very important that we keep our, to maintain a healthy gut, we have to feed the bacteria well.
Absolutely. And then for those who are in the process of already having digestive issues and not, their body's not able to break down the nutrients that they're getting, and even though you're taking prebiotic and probiotic, you may still not be getting the optimum results that you're looking for, because your body just doesn't have the necessary digestive enzymes to break down what it is that you're giving it. So then that is something that may need to be introduced into your regimen to get you over that hump and give you that extra push that you need to where your body can actively and adequately break down what it is that you're feeding it, so it can carry out again its function in nurturing your body and causing your body to flourish.
I agree. There are some digestive enzymes that can be taken. One brand that I know a lot of clinicians like to recommend is LipoGold. And it's really good at it. Well, for some patients, they actually like to use it because it helps them to, it adds the necessary digestive enzymes to, my apologies, it's called Enzyme Medica LipoGold. And basically it has, it includes enzymes to break down fats as well. Individuals have a hard time to break down fats. So digestive enzymes are also important, and also lifestyle measures too, to help us maintain the health of the bacteria in our gut. People forget about sleep, and what they don't know is that the bacteria in their gut also operate on a circadian rhythm. They kind of need to need periods of rest in a way too. So, you know, adults typically need 7 to 8 hours of sleep, 7 to 9 hours of sleep at night, which can be hard to get, but it is essential to helping us maintain healthy gut bacteria. Otherwise, we can actually disrupt our gut, our normal healthy gut bacteria, if we're not getting enough sleep. And many people who actually, there have been studies that show that individuals who don't get enough sleep tend to be at increased risk for obesity, cardiovascular disease, and also diabetes and high blood pressure.
And vice versa. If your gut is not well, that hinders the production of normal chemical hormones that your body need to get you into a restful state to where you can actually sleep properly throughout the night. So it's like a catch-22 thing. If you don't fix one thing, it disrupts another thing. And if you don't fix the other thing, it disrupts this one thing. So our body produces melatonin naturally. And the production of that happens in the gut, where you have different hormones. The body actually needs the good balance of bacteria in your gut to where your body can cause you to produce the natural chemicals that it needs to induce your sleep. So things like serotonin and melatonin that your body needs to get into a restful state. So another important aspect that we touched on briefly before is the aspect of weight gain that occurs when your gut is out of alignment and you don't have the proper bacteria in your gut to carry out the necessary function that you need for losing weight and for maintaining your weight loss. And oftentimes what happens is a process known as metabolic endotoxemia, to where your body is just reacting ridiculously out of whack because everything is out of alignment, essentially.
With metabolic toxemia, partly a result of leaky gut syndrome. So there's many risk factors for that, you know, including, you know, individuals who, whether strenuous exercise or not having a, you know, proper diet, as we spoke about earlier, and even certain medications. So with leaky gut syndrome, essentially the cells of your gut actually are tightly joined together by specific nutrients. So when they're disrupted, that actually allows for, you know, toxins from bacteria to enter into the bloodstream. And those toxins can actually precipitate an inflammatory response. So ultimately, one of the issues is that, you know, chronic inflammation does predispose an individual to obesity. As I mentioned earlier before, you know, bifidobacterium, which is one of the healthy gut bacteria, what it does is it promotes the production of an anti-inflammatory agent called IL-6. And ultimately what that does is it decreases the inflammatory proteins. But when your gut bacteria is out of whack, you have more bad gut bacteria, so to speak. You end up with more pro-inflammatory proteins. That's actually associated with obesity. And while the exact links aren't specifically known, you know, studies do show that individuals who are obese, they tend to have fewer healthy gut bacteria and also increased pro-inflammatory proteins. So yes, you know, as Kameisha was just saying, with the disrupted gut barrier, you know, that does increase one's risk for inflammation and also to obesity.
And chronic inflammation at that. So things like arthritis, fibromyalgia.
And even MS as well.
And even MS and Crohn's disease, IBS. Yeah. It's just a whole list of inflammatory processes. And things also like gastritis and ulcerative colitis, ulcers in the gut, all of those are so interconnected with your gut's microbiome being out of alignment. And along the same lines of weight gain, one of the things that happens too that causes your gut's microbiome to be out of balance or out of alignment is an increase in stress. And having some amount of stress is good because it activates your fight or flight response. But when you're in a chronic state of stress, your body also starts developing an elevated level of cortisol. And when you have an elevated level of cortisol, it increases your hunger hormone that's called ghrelin. And when you have an increase in ghrelin, what that causes you to do is crave things such as fat, high in carbohydrates, and sugar. You don't have to guess about that. All those three are recipe for increased weight gain if those are constantly consumed. And when you're highly stressed and your gut is out of balance and everything is out of alignment, you can bet that more often than not, you're going to see an increase in your weight.
Yes. I definitely agree with what you were saying, especially with the stress, just simply because the relationship between the gut and the brain, it's reciprocal. It goes back and forth. And certainly stress does cause you to crave foods that are more stimulating or sweeter. I'd say lots of sugary foods or like foods that are high in refined carbohydrates. Or fats, I meant to say. You know, but also too, as you were saying, like with the hormones that are released, they also disrupt the gut microbiota as well. So you end up with more harmful gut bacteria that also promote inflammation and weight gain. So it's almost like it's just going back and forth. It's just a vicious cycle.
Absolutely. By now, we've established that it's important to have good bacteria, but it's not just about having good bacteria. It's also about having a wide variety of bacteria that's going to work synergistically to give your body the optimal results to cause you to be a well-functioning human being. So there are different bacteria that act differently in the body to carry out different functions. There are bacteria that act on your immune system, bacteria that act on your mental wellness, bacteria that acts on the natural functions that occur in your gut and your digestive system. So altogether, there are so many different bacteria. And all the bacteria that are in your gut all have different purposes, and there need to be a wide variety or a diverse population of those bacteria to ensure that your body is efficiently and effectively functioning optimally as possible.
Yes, there's about 7,000 to 9,000 species of bacteria in your gut. So that's a lot. So yes, as Nurse Kameisha was saying, it's so important that our gut bacteria are diverse. You don't want to have, you know, more of one strain versus the other, because they all have different functions and they do work synergistically, which is why, you know, someone has a healthy gut or they're functioning normally, a probiotic might not always be recommended in their case, because most probiotics only have but a few of the thousands of strains that are in your gut, and you don't want to push out one strain and have more, you know, one type, or push out several strains and it's just not, you know, optimal for that individual. You know, that's why it's so important that individuals, you know, not only partner with a physician that understands, or at least that sees the need and the importance in promoting gut health, but also too, you know, you want to make sure that your main focus is actually your diet, because when you have a diet that has a variety of different, you know, fruits, vegetables, whole grains, legumes, that's what actually promotes the health of, you know, your gut bacteria and also the proportions of gut bacteria that you have. So that's really super important. And if necessary, a probiotic supplement, because some individuals do have a condition called leaky gut syndrome, which they may or may not be aware of. And when your gut's not functioning optimally, you can't absorb your nutrients properly. And as a result, some individuals may have have suffered from nutritional deficiencies. And so it's so important that we start with, you know, first taking care of the lining or the repairing the gut, essentially. And then, of course, eating the foods that promote the diversity of the gut. And, you know, just like your fingerprint, no two guts are alike. So, you know, again, there's like at most maybe a 10% similarity between my gut and your gut. So that's why it's so important for each person, you know, even to journal, you know, their health symptoms with even when it relates to like food sensitivities.
What you're eating.
Yeah. Journaling is so important because it also will help you to, you know, have a better idea of what's going on with your health and a better dialogue and relationship with your physician, because they can better help you to determine what's going on and potentially point you in the right direction as far as treatments and probiotic supplements and even certain types of testing for the gut, like a GI map test, because a GI map test will help you to the individual to, well, the physician to find out exactly what types of bacteria are present in your gut so they can optimize treatment for you.
Absolutely. And going back to the statement that we made initially, you are what you eat. So,
yes.
You know, the body is very forgiving. The body was designed to replenish itself over time with the different injuries and insults that we give to it. But ultimately, there is going to come a time when it is going to catch up with you. And so what you're eating today may not necessarily be reflected in your skin. You may have flawless skin. You may sleep well. You may do everything succinctly right now because your body is constantly working overtime to replenish and restructure your gut's microbiota. But there may come a time when your body gives out. There may come a time to when the body is just not able to replenish and restructure after being insulted or injured so many times and having to replenish itself. So it is very important to take a look at what it is that you're consuming. Is it feeding your body for the better, or is it heading towards the path of destruction, towards killing off your gut's microbiome, where it's killing off the diversification of your gut's bacteria, and ultimately will cause you to become inflamed, overweight, have episodes of insomnia, or just in general start having a bad health overall, to where you cannot pinpoint exactly what is going on, but you just know that your body is not functioning right. And it could simply be as simple as fixing your gut's bacterial level.
So yes, ultimately you are what you eat. It is very true. And we have to remember too that our bacteria are our friends.
Yes.
So many times we can be very afraid of the idea of having bacteria around, but they're actually there to protect us. You know, we work with them, they work with us. So we want to make sure that, you know, we feed them well. You know, we don't want to first put junk food in our bodies. You want to start with your fresh fruits and vegetables, your whole grains. You know, get to your sleep at night, 7 to 9 hours, lots of water, and also to learning how to manage our stress levels through meditation, prayer, exercise, all these things. You know, we thrive on it, but so does our gut bacteria. So we have to take care of our gut.
Absolutely. This may seem like a far-fetched idea that your gut's bacterial level could get so messed up to where it affects your overall function. But there are people in this world who've actually had to have fecal transplants. They've actually had to get the stool from another person transplanted into them to repopulate and recolonize their bacterial levels so that they can function. Because ultimately, without that good population of bacteria in their gut, they would die. Simple and literally as that. So yes, it is absolutely very necessary and very important to have a diverse microbiota and also to feed the bacteria that are in the gut so that they can carry out the necessary function in helping us to be whole, healthy human beings.
Yes, fecal biota transplants. I wouldn't say it's super new, but it's pretty revolutionary. You know, there are many studies that have even shown that if you were to take a sterile mouse that had no bacteria in their guts whatsoever and take the fecal matter from, say, an obese individual and transplant it into a mouse, that mouse would become obese. But if you were to take a lean mouse, the same mouse, or different mouse, I should say, with the same body composition, and that's also sterile, and then transplant the stool from a lean person into that mouse will still be lean. But the idea is that, you know, the type of the composition of the stool of an individual actually is an indicator of their health. You know, they've even seen something similar with, you know, transplanting fecal matter from someone that's depressed into a sterile mouse that didn't exhibit symptoms of fear or depression, and found that when they did that, the mice actually didn't, you know, were less able to carry out their task of swimming. They were more apprehensive. You know, a trait that's actually seen in individuals who have major depressive disorder. Now, as far as the fecal microbiota transplant, this has also been done as a curative measure for certain conditions like medication-resistant Clostridium difficile. And they found that it's also curative in these individuals and also other conditions as well. So it's amazing what this treatment can do in terms of reversing disease simply because of the bacteria in the capsule, the composition of the bacteria in that capsule to actually influence how our body's function.
Absolutely. So yes, again, you are what you eat, and it's important for you to pay attention to what you eat because ultimately it could affect your overall health and your overall life in general. So yes, again, pay attention to what you eat and make healthy choices. We are going to be leaving in or descriptions, different probiotics and different things that we take ourselves, the probiotics that Dr. Lambert takes and the one that I take. So if you're interested in what we're using, we will leave those in our descriptions and you can check those out. And then if you have any questions, don't hesitate to leave us a comment or find us on our different social media handles and ask us your questions. We'll be sure to answer them as best as we possibly can that could potentially help you in your journey to better life and better living in general. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Nurse Kameisha.
Thank you for collaborating with me, Dr. Lambert. I look forward to our future collaborations. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And if you enjoy content like this, consider subscribing to each of our channels so you can be up to date with what our thoughts are and with what we are daily discovering as we explore more into the world of gut health and how it affects our lives.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Nurse Kameisha, for inviting me to this live session. It's definitely been a pleasure.
Thank you.